You know, normally we start with just mute all, but I think tonight, before we mute all, there's something that we could do. And that would be give a huge round of applause to Dana G, who does a great job running the programs for us. So before we go on mute all, let's give her a big round of applause.
Yay! And let's give Ben a big round of applause for making sure we see the program.
Yeah. Thanks, everyone. Appreciate that, Paul. John Felix was making sure that we gave thanks to Dana for all of her work during the year, and he can't be here tonight, but Paul Roberts is going to be covering. So I'm going to go ahead and hit mute all, and then Paul, once we do that, feel free to unmute yourself and begin. Go ahead when you're ready, Paul.
Okay, good evening, everyone. My name is Paul Roberts. John Felix, our president at the moment, is on the water somewhere off Portland, Maine for one of his three special cruises that he teaches. So he asked me to say hello. We want to encourage everyone who hasn't joined yet to please join PHSNE and take a look at our new website, which is really fantastic, thanks to Reich and others. I have one major announcement to make. Many of you probably attended Photographica, which was one of the best ones we ever had, which considering the layoff, it went off very, very well. We already have a date for next year of April 22nd. That's done, it's confirmed. So we will again be at Newton North High School, which is probably the best place we've ever had in terms of the ease for dealer setup and parking for people attending the show. So April 22nd, put it on your calendar already for next year. Again, I hope you enjoy the Zoom meeting. We feel that the Zoom meetings are easier for everyone to attend, and more people from all over the place are attending, and also reminding you that you can go to our website and look at any one of over a dozen previous meetings. So please look at the website, and if you missed a meeting or find something interesting, just click on it. So this is a new thing really for PHSNE, and I think it's part of our growing into the 20, whatever century this is. Again, I'm gonna pass the baton to Dana.
Thanks, Paul. It's exciting about Photographica. The website, if you haven't already visited, is PHSNE.org, PHSNE.org, where you can see all of the previous presentations that we have archived on our YouTube channel. And before I introduce our speaker, Vladimir, just a few announcements. You probably saw that the screen is being recorded when you joined the meeting. And for this presentation, up in the top right corner, you'll see a view icon. And once we start the presentation, speaker view is best for this presentation. The bottom of the screen, you should see a chat balloon, like a speech balloon. If you could please type any questions you have into the chat, I will relay those to Vladimir during the presentation and at the end. Also, if you have any technical difficulties, please put them into chat, but please stay muted during the presentation and use chat for your questions and make sure they're being addressed to everyone so we can all see them. I think that's the default. Okay, PHSNE member Vladimir Khazan has presented for us before on Minox, Zeiss Icon, and Lomo. You can see his programs archived on our YouTube channel. He has an interest in the history of photography with its many sources of information. And tonight he is presenting on the company Ihagee, Exakta and its founder, Johan Steenbergen. Steenbergen founded the company almost at the beginning of World War I, and it existed until shortly after World War II. Ihagee is known mostly for 35 millimeter SLR Exaktas. Vladimir, it is all yours.
Thank you, Dana, and hello, everybody. I am Vladimir Khazan, and today we are going to talk about company name Ihagee, which spelled in German and pronounced in German this way. But mostly it's famous for its 35 millimeter SLR. Some people say it's the first one in the world, but there was another one before. We'll talk about it a little later. But now let us begin. And here is the beginning. So we are going to talk about Exaktas and the company named Ihagee and its founder, Steenbergen, Johan Steenbergen. Johan Steenbergen was born in the Netherlands. So he is not actually a German citizen, but he moved to Germany and he kept his citizenship for Netherlands. That actually saved the company for some period of time. But let's go step by step. He was one of the third, three children in the family. And his father owned a textile shop. Johan worked there in that shop, but he did not like what was going on there. His interest was in cameras, chemicals, and other technical stuff, not textile. So for that reason, when he grew up, he opened a little shop right around the corner from the textile shop, and he started selling cameras. The first camera he sold was this drop plate box camera. See, you can see this diagram over here. This diagram shows the camera with a magazine of plates. That's how it was set for making several shots without reloading the plates into the camera. And the camera had Steenbergen's name right here at the bottom. So that was the very first camera that carried Steenbergen's name. When he moved to Germany, and why Germany? Why exactly Dresden? Because Dresden was famous for the photographic industry. And that is exactly what interested Steenbergen. He started as an apprentice for Ernemann, for Heinrich Ernemann. Heinrich Ernemann, by those days, created a very big and very good company, very famous company. His cameras were all over the Germany and many other countries. And this is where you can see that little circle here. This is where Steenbergen worked. And this tower It is called Erneman Tower. Erneman Tower began a symbol of a Pentagon company. That tower was built specifically for this company, for Erneman building. So when Johan Steenbergen, that's him, being 20, 22, organized his company, his mother helped him financially. And he created this logo, and that logo went through the entire time while the company was working. So the company was founded in 1912. And the name of it, you can see it here, it's written in German. And it was abbreviated as IHG. The abbreviation IHG in German is pronounced as Ihagee. Ihagee. And this is exactly how people started call that this company, Ihagee. The contents came from another small company that went bankrupt, from Ludwig Loschau. And as I said before, finances came from his mother. So they were ready to start. And the first camera they built was Photorex. There was a big problem with this name, because those days in Germany, anything that was that included the word Rex was under big lock, right? And for that reason, Photorex was not allowed to be produced. So this is the camera. Basically, it looked like most of the folders those days, and the only innovation here was this little thumb screw. This is patent that Johan Steenbergen created. This, thanks to this, the camera could be pulled more. So not just to the end of this base, but then the entire base was able to be moved even more ahead. All right, so this is the company, and because of the time, you can see it's 12 and then 13 and then 14, that's World War I. The timing was really shaky, and the company was closed because people were drafted, and Steenbergen was forced to close the company. But then he reopened it again, and then he finally hired six people from Erneman company where he worked, and he made friends with them. They were woodworkers. Those days, woodworkers meant a lot to the photographic company, because cameras, Most of the cameras had wooden cases, and good woodworker meant a lot for the company. So these six woodworkers started as just regular workers, but for the time being, they became shareholders, and they were making all the decisions together. They used to say that Steenbergen never used his seniority, never showed his seniority. He was very democratic boss. So it was very, very pleasant to work with him, they said. These are cameras that were made by the company. As you can see, they all are folders. They're folding cameras with bellows, except for this one. This is plan path reflex. See, the word reflex tell us that it already has a mirror in it. And that means that the photograph, the person who takes the photograph sees exactly what the lens sees. So that was a step ahead. And this is the camera, how it looked, right? Why was that? Because people knew that all the other ways to view through the camera causes parallax. This one is a folding camera as well. So you can see this is the viewfinder and this is the lens. So the viewfinder is on top of the lens. So the closer the subject is to the camera, the more possibility is to cut the subject's head off or legs off, or you can encounter into any unexpected situation, right? This is how we explain that. We are going to talk about parallax. So this is camera obscura. It's a long time ago. So camera obscura usually is a box with a hole that projects outside images on the other wall of the camera. Here on this camera, you can see that one lens was added and also a mirror, 45 degree angle mirror was added. So the person, the painter in this case, was looking through the lens and sees exactly what was in front of the camera. So let's take a look again. So this camera, it is a camera obscura. It has one lens, single, and it has a mirror, so it's a reflex. So can't we say that this is a single lens reflex camera obscura? We probably can, right? It's kind of funny that SLR camera obscura, but it is. And this is about parallax. This is an old camera, old type camera, right? So what we see is what we take the picture of, right? Because we are looking through this lens. As progress went up and different type of cameras appeared, again, this viewfinder was on top of the taking lens. So the axes did not coincide, right? They were different. One is higher, the other one is lower. So if this palm tree would be close enough and the person wanted to take a picture of the bird sitting in the palm tree, it would not be possible because the lens did not see the bird. Instead, the lens was looking at the trunk. That's it. So instead of the bird, the person would have received a picture of a trunk. The same thing here, it's a twin lens camera, or not necessarily a twin lens. Again, the viewfinder is higher and the parallax exists as well, right? So take a look at these cameras. Everybody except for this one has a viewfinder higher on top of the taking lens. And this one is a 3D, is a stereo camera. And even in the manual, even in the manual to this camera, it's a very good camera, by the way, it's a realist stereo camera, but in the manual, you can see that to have that camera steady, you have to hold it against your forehead. So something like this, right? So the person who takes the, who is trying to take a stereo slide with this camera would look like this. Yes, it is flat to my forehead, but the lenses are much higher, and I do not exactly know what will fall into my frame. But with the distance, it's the parallax influence goes lower and lower and lower, and the further away from the camera the subject is, the parallax comes closer to zero, because the view angle of the viewfinder is much wider than the lenses, right? The only camera that does not have a parallax is SLR, single lens reflex camera. Why is that? Because as you can see, this is the same palm tree, this is the same lens, and the mirror and the either film or digital camera, in case of digital camera, it's a sensor, doesn't matter, right? So the distance from here to the eye is the same as from here to the film. So when we focus the lens, we actually pretend that whatever is in front of the camera goes to here, goes to the lens, to the film. For that reason, people started making SLR cameras, single lens reflex cameras. And Steenbergen created, not him exactly, but the people who he worked with, created the camera Exacta. Exacta made the company very famous. The first camera that was created was using 127 film. And it is kind of tradition, right? It is a tradition that cameras that use roll film, right? Cameras that use roll film, they have a film advancement mechanism on the left, and also the push button to take the picture is on the left as well, right? So when they created Exacta. They did exactly the same thing. They left the advancement mechanism on the left, and also they left the push button, on the left as well. This is the push button, right? And this way, the way the push button is located on Exacta is much better than comparing to this way, if the button would be vertically. Why is that? Because especially beginners, when they take a shot, they most very, very often, they do this, right? And the shot becomes blur, right? Here, you don't do this. You push it against yourself, right? Having the camera against your face and pushing the button towards yourself actually makes it more steady than vertically. So the first camera that they created, the first Exacta that they created was VP Vest Pocket, famous since plate cameras, this format, Vest Pocket, famous from 4.5 by 6 centimeters plate cameras, right? And further on, they improved the camera, adding some additional mechanisms. And finally, in 1936, they came up with Exacta Kine. It's not Kine, it's Kine. Kine stands for Cine. In English, we would have said Cine, cinema. Why is that? Because of the film, right? Because that camera used 35 millimeter movie film, right? So this is Johan Steenbergen, and this is logo of this company, Ihagee. And this is the designer, very talented engineer. This person, unfortunately, did not live long. I'll talk about him just in a couple of minutes. But this is the camera that he created. Basically, Carl Nüchterlein, this person, created this camera, created Exacta. And these are main characteristics of that camera, right? So popular, the first popular 35 millimeter SLR camera. The key word in this bullet point is popular. It is not the first in the world. It's the first popular camera. Because the very first camera was created in the Soviet Union. And it was not developed further because of the war, because of the Second World War. Because it was created in Leningrad, and in 1941, Leningrad was bombed by Nazis. And of course, it was not a very good time for making cameras those days. But Exacta Kine was presented at Fair Leipzig in 1936. And a very interesting moment. They came up with their own bayonet, Exacta Ihagee Ihagee own bayonet. That bayonet allowed to replace lenses very fast. Next thing that was new, comparing even to the first Exactas, film advance lever. So this this lever is a new invention made by Ihagee. Well, the camera is pretty heavy. Body only 720 grams, and this one is closer to a kilo. So 1 kilo is about 2.2 pounds. So you can understand that this is a heavy camera. And the bigger cameras they made, the heavier they were, right? So this slide is about Carl Nüchterlein. See, he was born in 1904, and he was missing in Yugoslavia in 1945, right before the end of the war, April. The war ended, Second World War ended in Berlin in May 1945. So just if you, it was beginning of the May, actually May 8th, and he was probably killed and lost somewhere in action in Yugoslavia in April. Unfortunately, just one month, and the world lost such a great designer. You can read, I'm not going to read all this, but he was, in 1942, he was drafted to Wehrmacht and was missing since April 1945. This slide is about the other camera that was really the first one in the world, the first 35 millimeter SLR in the world. It was manufactured in 1935, and it was produced in Leningrad. There was a long story, as they usually have it in, had it in Soviet Union before something new will make a way to the people. A lot of things must happen. So was with this camera. It was cassette to cassette camera, so two sides cassettes. By the way, Exacta can be used the same way. But our days, well, it's not already our days, it's in the past when we used Kodak films, right? They were coming in specific cassettes, that the films were coming in specific cassettes. But for this type of cameras, we have to be able, if this is the film, we have to be able to open the cassette, take the film out. Don't worry, it's not brand new film. It's specifically for demonstrations. And we have to put it another way in. So in the camera, one cassette is supposed to be this way, right? And the other one is supposed to be this way. But the film has to go specific way, so it can be hooked up to the take-ups pole or cassette. And this is one of the old Soviet cassettes that can be opened and reloaded as we wish. Very, very convenient. So this is the camera that was there before Exacta, but unfortunately it was not developed after the World War II was over. There was a lot of problems in the country, in Soviet Union, and they did not pay attention to new cameras, right? So next couple of slides will be about the timeline on Exacta. What exactly would we have on Exacta? I'm sorry for this repetition, what exactly we have on Exacta, but that's what it is. So what we see here is a VP, Exacta VP. And based on that, the next one is Exacta Kine, right? It has only one possibility to view through waist level finder, but it already has the lever to advance the film, and it has the bayonet for the lens. By the way, all the lenses are interchangeable. If you have a Kine Exacta and you have Exacta as Paul just showed, the lenses were absolutely interchangeable, right? So next model was created in 1949, and this camera is already prism ready. This is Exacta 2. You can see this number 2, Roman number 2 over here. Interchangeable finders requires front plate removal. So to replace the shot, we have to remove this front plate, several screws. As you can understand, people did not do it every moment, so it was not as convenient, right? The next was interchangeable hood and screen unit, twin synchronizers, sockets for bulb and electronic flash. And this little thing, now we can see, I can show it to you on this camera. It has, right, I'm pushing it down. And I can remove the shut and replace it with the eye level pentaprism.
Vlad.
Yeah.
When you're sharing the image of yourself with the camera, you're very, very small on the screen. So if you want to, when you're demonstrating something, stop screen sharing for a moment so that your picture will be larger so we can see you.
Uh-huh. I can simply switch cameras.
Okay.
Okay. So like this. And
Vladimir, how you have it right now is perfect. You don't need to switch anymore, but just to stop sharing the screen so we can see full screen.
Just a second. 20, right? So this is the camera. Can you see it better? Yes.
That looks great, Vlad.
Yeah. Okay. All right. All right. So can you see it now? Can you see my screen now? Yes?
Good. Yes.
Good. So electronic flash would work here. And finally, 1951, Exacta VX hinged instead of removable back, and optional cassette to cassette working. I already described it. I don't think I need to switch to the other camera. And actually, I can do that right now, but. This is the inside of the camera, and instead of the take-up spool, we can put a cassette which will fit, but the other cassette must be upside down. For that reason, I just showed how these old Soviet cassettes are very good for this kind of operation. Okay. All right, so let's continue. In 1955, Exacta VX with a PC type flash. Does anyone know what PC stands for? It does not stand for personal computer. Those days we didn't have that. PC stands for Pronter Comfort. Two types of shutters, and that's how flashes worked. Okay. Now, next one, 2A, Exacta VX 2A. Very minimal difference. Logo is raised letters. So instead of engraved, it was stamped here. And the next one was a little different. It was Exacta 2B, Exacta 2B. You can see different interface, different look for this camera. However, the top plate is still metal, unplated, and it's just the same old Exacta. Okay, that was 1963. 1967 is Exacta VX 1000. Exacta 1000, here it is. Well, this camera is kind of handicapped because someone who owned it before me was probably too strong, and they broke this lever. See, this lever is broken off, or maybe they bit it off. I don't know. It's very difficult to tell.
Vlad, can you stop sharing your screen so we can see the camera?
Oh, you don't see it?
It's very, very tiny.
Okay.
There you go.
Okay. Can you see it now?
Yes.
Okay. So you can see this lever actually broken up. Right? It's still possible to use it, but it's very difficult. It's very difficult. Okay. So let's continue. And that was 1967. And on that 1967 model, already mirror was returning. So whether the shutter is cocked or not, the photographer could see through the lens.
There's a comment from someone. Richard says window sizes can be adjusted with a slider between windows.
Okay, this one. Which window size? Which window he was talking about?
Richard, do you want to unmute and clarify?
Okay, probably not.
Okay.
Probably not. So let's continue. And that was the last one that was created in 1969. Comparing to 1000, VX500 is the lower cost, right, model.
There's one. Vlad.
Yeah.
There's one more question. Drew said, did he say what type of metal this model had? Couldn't he have had some piece added to the advance knob?
Just needs to be replaced, the whole thing, because the way it's broken off, I don't think it's possible to, can you see it? I'm not sure. I can switch again, right here. It's right here. I don't think it's possible to fix this particular lever. I think it just has to be replaced.
Two more questions. Bill asks, when did the first camera with film lever advance on the right side come out?
We'll be there in a few minutes.
Okay. And what Richard added was, when two windows are side by side, the sizes can be adjusted by the viewer. And Takayuki says, place the cursor between two screens and move it right or left to change sizes. Oh. Sorry.
Okay. All right. So thank you very much for that. So let's continue. We are back to Germany, and this is the project, how the building for the factory, Ihagee factory, looked on the paper. Right. This is how it looked in reality. And this is how it looked in February 1945, after bombing, when Dresden was bombed and everything in this factory was destroyed. For that reason, it is very difficult to find out the real story about Exacta. For that, this is the reason why we do not know the full history for the Ihagee company, right? And not just this, but after the war, Dresden was on the Eastern Germany territory. It was very difficult to get documentation from their government about just about anything. All right. This slide shows how difficult it was to continue to produce cameras when Steenbergen was not there. And he was not there because he was forced to leave Germany when Hitler was in power. But we'll get there in a few minutes. And here you can see this little label on the building saying that this is Ihagee company, and that's all that's left from the company, because the company was practically eaten by company that produced very big cameras. Very big cameras. Those very big cameras were these. They are good cameras, and I showed it already. It's Pentagon.
Vlad, can you stop screen sharing so we can see?
One second.
Great.
Yeah. Right. So this is the camera. Pentagon. Right. Pentagon 6, and it was made by the same company that you just saw sign on the wall. And we discussed that a little while ago when I was talking about Zeiss and other German companies. But in our case with Exakta, Pentagon practically ate the Exakta out. And that's this little sign actually was all that's left from the company. The reason why Steenbergen was forced to leave Germany was because his wife was of Jewish heritage. And because Hitler's anti-Semitic policies, it was not safe for them to stay in the country. On one hand, Steenbergen himself was not German citizen. And on the other hand, his wife was a citizen, a United States citizen. So, after they were released from the prison, they were imprisoned for a couple of days. They left Germany and they went to United States, where they were met by Netherlands embassy, and Steenbergen became a consul in the United States as well. I did not say that before. Before he was a consular of Netherlands in Germany. So that happened in 1942. But in 1945, when the war was over, Steenbergen was appointed as a military attaché in the French zone of Germany. There was a funny situation. You can see it here. I described it here. He was given the rank of colonel, but he was never in service. So he did not know who to salute to. And he saluted Dorman and all the people who were wearing any kind of uniform, right? But talking about cameras again, the company Pentacon continued producing Exactas. They did not call them Exactas, they called them Exa. They called them Exa. And here we go. These cameras were almost the same as Exactas, but they were a little less complicated. They did not have as much for shutter speeds. You can see here, this one comes only to 150. It was not as good as Real Exacta. So they were still good, but not as good as before. And this is the answer to the question, when Exacta became, when it was possible to shoot left and right. This is the camera that has right and left, two buttons. For that reason, it is called Twin. Twin TL. Twin stands for two buttons, and TL through the lens. Right? So that's how it worked. And this one, this camera, was a Kickstarter. They wanted to revive Exacta, but it was not possible because they were going to work close with the Ukrainian engineers, and Arsenal factory was destroyed, demolished. So continuation of this cameras were not possible. That's about it for this presentation. And thank you everybody who was able to finish this presentation with me. Thank you.
Thank you, Vlad. Folks, if you want to unmute and give Vlad a round of applause, and then we'll get to some more questions.
There we go.
Good job.
Hold on, Vlad.
All right.
It's a complicated story. It is very complicated.
So, story. Vlad, the last camera you showed wasn't actually Exacta. It was just a Japanese use of the name, correct?
Yes.
And that took Pentax lenses, Pentax mount lenses.
Actually, Nikon.
No, not that one, the one before. That was the one made by Cosina.
Yeah.
That actually took screw mount lenses, I believe.
Yes, actually it was, it was started on in Germany a long time ago, in Eastern Germany. When they, as you know, they produced cameras with a screw mount, they wanted to use their lenses on Exacta as well. So for that reason, they had two types of cameras produced. So
there are a few questions, and Jack has a show and tell after that.
Sure.
Reich had asked, were all the Exactas made out of aluminum, not brass, like many high-end cameras?
Well, if they were made out of aluminum, they would not be that heavy. That is steel. This is a real steel, right? Axes are a little lighter than, let's say, real Exactas, right? This one is a lot heavier than this one. Unfortunately, Zoom does not give the
yeah
yet, but probably soon you will be able to feel the weight and heaviness of the subject that we are talking about.
I just, as a follow-up question, I had no idea that the I thought that the Exa and the Exacta was sort of ran in parallel, because I remember seeing them in photo magazines in the early 70s and that sort of thing. But they stopped the one and came up with the other. How?
Yeah. Actually, this Exa, this particular camera, belongs to the very first batch of cameras produced. After these cameras, they shut the line and they opened the other line, which was called Exacta 2, but Exa 2, but Exa 2 has nothing to do with Exa 1. It's a total different camera.
Lenses were all interchangeable between the Exacta and the Exa?
If they are not screw mount lens, then yes.
Jack, did you want to show your show and tell?
Yes, and I have a one, excuse me, I have a 1 minute story to go with it.
Put your voice on.
We can hear you.
Okay.
Oh, you can hear me. Yes. I thought I put it on. About 8 years ago, I was 80, and Claire and I had been collecting cameras since 1970. Wow. And two years after that, we joined PHSNE and were members for a lot of years. And I used to go to the flea market every Sunday. I went to auctions, and we went to the shows. We went to the New York shows as well as our shows. So we covered a lot of ground looking for cameras. We went to yard sales every Saturday, and we went to flea markets on Sunday. So when I turned 80, I says, this is it. I just can't get up early anymore. I had to get up before 6 o'clock to get there when the dealers come in at the flea market. And the grass was always all wet from the dew. I just got tired of walking in the wet grass. So I says, this is going to be my last day. So I got there early and I flew around and I hit all the dealers as they were unpacking, and I didn't have any luck. I didn't find a single thing. So then I says, I'll walk through slowly once more and then leave. I got about to the middle of the flea market and there was a lady there, and I had bought several cameras off her through the years. She used to sell them for the Salvation Army. And I said, I didn't say anything. She says, I got a bargain for you today. She says, everything on that blanket on the ground there is $5. And she had a whole bunch of stuff on the blanket. And she says, look in that yellow bag. And it was a stinky old yellow bag sitting there. And I picked it up, it was heavy. I said, wow, there's something good in here. And I looked inside, and the first thing I pulled out was these two lenses. Can you see them all right, the way I'm holding them?
Yeah, they're shining.
One lens is a Jena, J-E-N-A, 1:2, 58 millimeter. And the other one is an Emma Super Lithogon. It's tough to say these things. 1.25, and those were the two lenses that came with it that were loose. And when I pulled the camera out of the bag, here's what came out. This is an Ihagee. Now, in all those years of collecting cameras, and you know, we handled hundreds and hundreds of cameras through the years, this is the first time I ever had one of these. This is, and this here is 1956, as close as we can tell, but Vlad, you can correct me if I'm wrong. It's an Exacta Varax 2A, and it has a leather case. And this lens here is a Telequina 200 millimeter. Out of all the things we collected through all the years, this is the last one. This was the last one we got. And I forgot I had it until I read a few weeks ago that Vlad was going to give this talk. And we talked about it. I said, I got one like that somewhere. And I went and looked in the case where the Zeiss set was. And up on the top shelf, this camera was sitting there kind of forlorn because Jack didn't play with it all the time it's been sitting there. So I just wanted to show you my very last camera that I got.
Those Steinheil lenses were very sharp.
Say that again?
Those Steinheil lenses were very sharp. They were very good quality.
The lenses are very good.
Oh, the lenses are good?
That lens is very good.
Okay, well, I'm glad to hear that. I haven't tried it. I really should go out and take some pictures with it, but it weighs a ton. Like I said, they're pretty heavy, but it's working. It's you know, it's a great camera, and I can see where it's a quality camera. I don't think many of these got to the USA because, like I said, all that collecting of cameras, this is the only one I've ever had.
Yeah.
That's actually, my job.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Jack. Actually, I have to say, I've never said it, that Ihagee mostly worked for export. They did not sell as many cameras within Germany as they sold company cameras for outside.
Okay.
And in the United States, I think in the United States, it was marketed as Exacta VX. The other countries, it was Varex, V-A-R-E-X. Again, it has the word Rex in it, so it was impossible to sell in Germany, right? So here, if I will take this lens off and will give it to you, that will fit to your camera, and your lens will fit to my camera.
Okay.
Right. Not only because we have the same cameras, but all Exactas fit, all cameras fit to one to another. If I will take this Exa off and replace it with the lens that I just took off my Exacta 2A. Here we go. It's on and it fits perfectly.
Sid has a comment that the most famous Exacta with a lens was in the Hitchcock movie Rear Window with Jimmy Stewart, and the lens was about 500 millimeters.
Yeah.
The lens that Jimmy Stewart had was a 400 millimeter lens. Right. I have one of those lenses, but it doesn't fit this camera. It fits a Leica. I can get it and show it to you.
And what is the reason that Rex was not allowed to be used?
I'm sorry, I can't hear what you're saying.
I'm sorry. What was the reason that the word Rex was not permissible?
Because it means the king.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
All right.
And I have just two quick things to show. One is the Exacta handbook. If you can see this, can you see it like a little bit?
Yeah.
And on the back page, just the interchangeability is kind of featured with the pentaprisms and the lenses. This is a pretty cool thing. And then I also have this twin TL, which Vlad made famous tonight. So it's got the trigger here plus here.
But that's not a real Exacta. That's a Cosina.
Yeah, this is the one that was shown. So,
right.
Yeah, great job, Vlad.
Thank you. And Ben, thank you very much for reminding me. I was going to show this book as well. This is
fantastic.
Cameras. Yeah, I used it a lot for this presentation.
Ben.
Yeah.
I love the biographical information on Steenbergen and Nuchterlein, how you found out he was a democratic boss.
I don't remember by heart. It came from the workers, from one of those six woodworkers that he hired from Erneman, and one of them was saying that he never used his seniority, not just seniority, but he owned more shares than them, because he owned the company. He had like 60 something percent of the company, right? And as they said, he always listened to them. He never said, "I said so, that's why it's correct." Right? So that's how I learned that.
The lens that they talked about for the Jimmy Stewart movie is this one here. It's called a Kilpin lens. It's 400 millimeter, but this has got a Leica thread on it. It doesn't fit this camera.
Right. Yeah,
but this is what they used in a movie.
Mm-hmm. You can get a mount. You can Kilpin made mounts for including Exacta.
Right.
The Kilpin Berea mount was interchangeable. I might note one thing. Exacta cameras for a camera collection. You can get a very pretty Exacta for very little money, and it looks very nice on the shelf.
You need a strong shelf if you're going to have more than one of those.
The Exacta cameras are not selling for a lot of money at this point.
So how are we for doing?
A collection, they're very pretty and they don't cost a lot.
Vlad,
by the way, just much. As a note, the Celtics were ahead by 6 points the last time I looked.
Thanks, Paul. Ben, how are we doing for time?
Well, I think the presentation was good.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Vladimir was excellent once again. Thank you, Vladimir.
Thank you,
Dana, I think we have just like a few more minutes if there's any last show and tells or anything or anyone wants to say goodnight. But it's probably a good time to kind of like wind things down.
Before we will finish it, I would like to say a couple of words. Sid sent me an email, and in that email, he mentioned Nicholas Graver. Nicholas Graver made a comment to my presentation before I did the presentation. Right. So, his question was about the camera being left-handed, right? As I said before, almost all the cameras that used roll film were advancing film to the left. And as I showed before, I will use a smaller camera, right? So this is the unit. You advance the film here, and the push button is right here. So you move it, you watch your roll film numbers going by, and then you push the button, right? And this is a wonderful Zeiss. It works. It's a wonderful camera. I love it. All right. But this camera, the camera I showed you before, I just recently received it. It's a realist stereo camera. I just received it from my nephew as a birthday gift. Right. So it was a pleasure and big surprise when I opened the box and I saw this camera. I just was very happy. I decided to use this camera for this presentation as soon as I saw it. Okay, that's the story about it.
Well, that's a great camera and happy birthday.
Thank you. In the past, fortunately, oh, fortunately.
I just want to mention before we sign off that there are no meetings in July and August. We will be back in September. And so during those months, you know, feel free to rewatch the archived talks. And if anyone has any suggestions for speakers or presentations, you can email me at programs@bisney.org. Programs with a plural. Ben, any other notes that you have?
No, I think that's it for now. It was great to see everyone tonight. And Vladimir, once again, thank you very much. I think we can give him one more round of applause. Yes.
Thanks, Vlad.
Thank you. Dana, one question. Will we have show and tell in December?
I'm not sure. It's become sort of a tradition. I think we all enjoy it, so I hope so.
Yeah, that would be nice.
We might even have a combination of Zoom and live with show and tell in December. Maybe. Wishful thinking, but if we do have any live meetings, they will also be on Zoom, because that's become very important for people in other parts of the country and also other photographic groups all over the world. They are monitoring what we're doing.
Yep.
Okay.
That's a fact.
Thanks, Paul.
All right. Well, great to see everyone tonight. Have a good night and take care. I'll see you soon.
Thank you, Ben. Right. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Thanks, Vlad.
Bye, all.
Thank you.
Have a great summer.
You too.